My name is Talia, and today we will learn what's new in SF symbols. A symbol is one of the most effective single pieces of graphic communication. If you ever want to represent a feeling, an object, an action, or a concept, symbols are an excellent way to do so. Symbols are used frequently and consistently, becoming second nature to us. Without relying on them, we will find it very difficult to navigate our surroundings. As a result, they become an essential part of interface design, as symbols are an excellent way to aid in communication. A symbol can bring many benefits by being a means of interaction, being space efficient, enhancing the aesthetic appeal, and engaging us by being user-friendly. What is so great about a symbol is that it can transcend many languages. They can be universal. As a result, symbols can unite people in communicating shared ideas, helping engage with others on a deeper level than is possible with just words. At Apple, we care deeply about making the user interface and the overall experience better. That's why we created SF Symbols, an extensive library of iconography designed to integrate seamlessly with San Francisco, the system font, providing a powerful and flexible design resource for creating experiences on all Apple platforms. SF Symbols is designed with typography in mind. It has awesome features like different weights, scales, outlined and field variants, encapsulated shapes, and alignments. To learn more about these features and when it's best to use them, check out last year's video from WWDC to get you up to speed. Today, we will take a look at the new repertoire and the new categories in new symbols. In rendering modes, we will review the benefits of adding colors to symbols, and we have a new configuration to help make the symbol's behavior automatic. We have a new exciting feature called variable color. Here we will explore the use of color to make a symbol more dynamic. And finally, we have a more efficient way of annotating symbols. We will learn more about it in unified annotations. So let's get started. The SF Symbols library keeps growing each year with newer categories and symbols to choose from. There are some great additions for home, including lights, blinds, windows, and doors. We even have light switches and power outlets. There are new furniture and appliances, and new health symbols. And this year, our fitness figures are available for you to use. We have expanded the library's currency symbols, and we have many new objects to choose from. And of course, we keep expanding our localized symbols with new ones covering different scripts and right-to-left writing systems. There are over 700 new symbols to choose from, making SF Symbols a library of more than 4,000 unique symbols. That is amazing. With all these new additions, we wanted to help you navigate through all the symbols in the SF Symbols app. So we've added 5 new categories that we think will be super helpful. Camera and photos, accessibility, privacy and security, home, and fitness. And remember that in the app, you can always create your own collection with a selection of symbols that best suits your needs. Now, let's have a quick reminder about the different rendering modes. As you may know, in SF Symbols, there are 4 rendering modes to choose from, each one providing a gradient control over how color is applied to a symbol. Monochrome is the most neutral of all the rendering modes. It gives a uniform and consistent look, and it is the rendering mode that most closely reflects the typographic nature of SF Symbols. Hierarchical is the rendering mode that provides a subtle emphasis while having a single color hue drive the overall aesthetic. We can apply depth by highlighting the most important shape of a symbol or differentiate the foreground and background elements. That way, we create a visual hierarchy by emphasizing the essential part or parts of a symbol. Palette uses 2 or more contrasting colors to give elements of a symbol more prominence and versatility, allowing for the symbols to be customized to integrate with the color palette of the environment. Palette helps the symbols have a contrasting and unique look without sacrificing the overall aesthetic. and multicolor is the rendering mode that represents the intrinsic or native color of a symbol. This rendering mode uses a range of colors that can be applied to a symbol to describe the appearance of an object in the physical world, or it can use colors to emphasize the meaning that the symbol is trying to convey. You can use multicolor when the symbols are very prominent in the UI, as it will help create a color narrative that will relate to the symbol forms. Until now, if you didn't explicitly specify a rendering mode, you will get monochrome by default. But this year, we've made it easier to display symbols in a rendering mode that best highlights each symbol's unique characteristics. Symbols now feature a preferred rendering mode, which can vary between symbols. And we call this behavior automatic rendering. When selected, it provides the preferred rendering mode configuration for each symbol, without having to specify it manually. For example, when automatic is selected, the camera filter symbol will opt into hierarchical, as it is a rendering mode that conveys a more precise visual representation by highlighting the opacities that reference the translucency of the physical camera lenses and filters. Here's another example. When automatic is selected, the SharePlay symbol participates in the hierarchical rendering mode. This behavior lets the person's shape stand prominently in the foreground, while the waves play a secondary role in the background. Again, this emphasizes the symbol's concept, as the SharePlay feature is mainly a way to share and connect with friends and family. In most cases, automatic will be the best way to go. But you always have to be aware of the context. For example, the AirPods Pro symbol will render as hierarchical when automatic is selected. But in this context, the symbol is very small and has low contrast when presented on this background. Remember that rendering modes can still be explicitly specified for a uniform appearance across symbols in a particular context. So in this case, monochrome would be the best choice as it is more legible and has fewer details at small sizes. So always make sure to specify the most suitable rendering mode configuration. The different rendering modes apply color to symbols to present visual solutions for a wide range of circumstances. Color is a powerful tool, and we can explore it even further. Some symbols are more dynamic in nature. If we analyze their visual representation, we can notice two main characteristics. First, their paths or shapes convey at varying levels of strength. And second, they rely on color to communicate their status changing over time. This year, we're expanding the use of color by introducing a new feature called variable color. We've arranged the symbol's vector path into layers and organized those layers in sequential order, creating a new method of distributing color through these layers. This allows us to convey different levels of strength or communicate a sequence over time, which is dictated by the nature of the design of the symbol. One important thing to know is that in variable color, some symbols have all paths participating in the sequence, but for other symbols, only some of the paths may opt in. Let's look at a few examples. With variable color, we want the path representing the iPhone to opt out of the variable sequence, and we want to highlight the path representing the radio waves. This will help differentiate the stages that describe the levels of strength of the radio signal of the phone. It's important to know that we define how we want to group the paths. For example, it wouldn't make much sense to highlight the waves from left to right in this case. So instead, we can group the paths following the sequence that best conveys the radio signal strength. We have the two smaller waves in one layer, and we have the two bigger waves in a different layer. And as mentioned, the phone does not participate in the variable sequence. This time, let's look at a symbol that we're very familiar with. In most cases, this symbol is paired with a built-in slider that syncs with the state represented in the symbol. The waves highlight their paths following a sequence dictated by the user control in the slider, increasing or decreasing the volume level. Like in the iPhone example, we have a path that doesn't participate in the sequence, which is the shape illustrating the speaker. And we have paths that do participate in the sequence, which are the three waves that define the volume strength: low volume, mid volume, and high volume. These paths are organized into layers, and the selected layers opt into the variable color feature. We represent their strength with percentage values. 0% is entirely off. Anything above 0% will highlight part of the symbol, and the whole symbol will be fully highlighted as the value approaches 100%. One important thing to know is that variable color is not meant to create depth. Instead, it's meant to highlight a sequence of steps or stages that the symbol can represent. For example, let's imagine I need a symbol to represent people's capacity inside a room. This symbol looks great for that. Let's look at it in more detail. We don't want to highlight just one part of the symbol. Instead, we need to think of the symbol as a sequence or a range. My goal is to cover different states. The room is empty. The room has few people in it. The room is half full. And the room is at full capacity. So now, when I opt into variable color, I can easily see the graphic representation of the different states I'm trying to convey. And there are no limits to how many paths can opt into the feature. There can be just one or many. You decide what is the design strategy that best suits your needs. If you want to represent the strength level of shapes that follow a sequence, like waves, rays, ellipses, and layers, you can do so with variable color. Variable color is opacity-based, and it's available in all rendering modes. This year, we have made annotations for custom symbols faster and easier to use by creating a unified layer structure across all rendering modes. I love baking, and I was thinking of designing an app with cupcake-only recipes. I wanted to create my own custom symbols, so I've designed a set that will cover my needs. This will be an excellent opportunity to show you how to annotate symbols with a unified layer structure approach and how to annotate symbols that participate in variable color. Let's use these two as an example. Before we start annotating, there are a few things to consider. We need to keep the hierarchy in mind and make sure we outline the C order. The C order refers to the order of the paths in a symbol along the C axis. There are also two new concepts you need to be aware of: draw and erase. These are used to help define the way a layer renders. For example, here we have the paths of a symbol representing a square overlapping a circle. When selecting the layers containing the square, if we choose the draw option, the layer will draw the paths contained in that layer. If we choose the erase option, the layer will erase the path containing the layer, affecting how the symbol is rendered. Now let's start annotating the cupcake. As a first step, we need to organize the path in layers to create the desired hierarchy. If I analyze it closely, I can see four main shapes: the frosting, the cupcake base, the budge, and the plus. You can add as many paths as needed to a layer. So in this case, the frosting will be defined by a layer with three different paths, and the rest of the layers will be defined by just one path each. Organizing the shapes in this way allows us to have more flexibility when annotating one structure for all rendering modes. Now we have all the information we need in one place to customize the symbol as needed. Now we can start annotating all rendering modes. Let's look at multicolor first. I already have the shape set up, so I just need to choose the right colors. Red velvet is my favorite flavor, so I'll choose white for the frosting and red for the cupcake base. Now I will follow the same logic that SF Symbols defines for the plus budgets in multicolor: green for the badge and white for the plus. Okay, this is looking great so far. Now let's focus on the badge. This is where the unified annotation approach is more apparent. We already defined multicolor. Now let's look at hierarchical and palette. because of the use of hierarchy in these rendering modes, I would expect the badge to be primary, which will render it white on a black background like this one. Now I need the plus shape to erase part of the badge. This is where the erase selection is helpful. I will be able to see the badge render as desired by erasing a part of a shape when the layers overlap. Finally, I just need the monochrome annotation. Because there's no added complexity in this rendering mode, I will follow the same logic, making the plus shape erase part of the badge shape. I'm almost done now. I just need a few extra details. For hierarchical and palette, I just need to annotate the rest of the cupcake shape as secondary. For palette, I will choose a color to give a bit of contrast. And for monochrome, I just need to make sure I have the remaining shapes opting into draw. That's all I need. The cupcake is ready and customized for all rendering modes. Now let's look at the kitchen timer. The paths represent the time passing, and since this is a sequence, it's a great candidate to participate in variable color. We can use the same strategy to annotate the symbol, but instead of grouping the timer paths in one layer, we need to split them with each in its own layer. This is because we need to organize the shapes to allow us to recreate the sequence that will help us communicate the different states of the symbol. And remember that variable color works in all rendering modes. If you want to learn more about the new variable color feature and the SF Symbols app, check out Paul's talk, Adopt Variable Color in SF Symbols. You can find a new beta version of the SF Symbols app, where you can explore the new unified annotation approach and access the hundreds of new symbols and fantastic new features. Check out developer.apple.com/SFSymbols. From automatic render behavior to the variable color dynamic nature, SF Symbols are an extremely powerful tool to use when implementing symbols in your UIs. And this year, SF Symbols is even more powerful with features that define a spectrum of expression. Thank you for joining today. I hope you enjoy learning about what's new in SF Symbols.